I'm Norman Wildberger. Today we're going to ask the question, what is geometry really about? And the answer may surprise you. We are asking this question right now because it directly bears to our project of understanding quadrilaterals, which is a step up from understanding triangles. Historically, we can give at least three possible answers to this question. Probably long before geometry was studied formally, people were interested in pictures with a geometrical content. Artists, craftsmen, would have created patterns like this involving geometrical objects. So at some point, for example, someone probably realized that you could put six equal circles around a circle, that a hexagon was composed of a bunch of equilateral triangles, that a pentagram was an interesting kind of pattern. Somewhat later, when the Greeks started thinking about geometry more formally, they might have answered this question with the idea that geometry is constructions. For example, the famous problem of Apollonius asks, how do you construct a circle which touches three given circles? So the blue ones are given, and we want to try to find a green one which touches all three of them. Well, in fact, there's more than one solution. You can try to convince yourself that there are, in fact, eight solutions. And here's a special case when the three given circles are themselves mutually tangent. In this case, there's only two solutions, one around there and one around there. And although we can see that those solutions exist, how do we actually construct them with a ruler and compass? That would have been a main kind of motivating idea for geometry for the ancient Greeks. The more modern approach to the subject is that geometry is really about theorems. It's about facts that we can state and that we can prove. And this is, I would say, the 20th century approach. Try to create lots of theorems which are statements about geometrical objects. It's probably important for me to mention that our understanding of geometry is prejudiced by our fabulous ability to process visual information. Our brains have huge capacity for comprehending three-dimensional imagery and processing it and capturing a lot of information in a visual image. So we are kind of in tune with geometry as a visual subject. But it's not necessarily so intrinsically. And the answer that I want to propose to this question is not on this list. It's something else entirely. And it's something that's much less visual than you might have thought. So what is geometry really about? In my opinion, geometry is really about formulas. At the heart of the subject are formulas, algebraic expressions that capture relationships between geometrical concepts. In our presentation of rational trigonometry so far, I've mentioned the five main facts of the subject, and these are all formulas. Let me remind you what they are. These are the five most important formulas in geometry, and in my view, probably the five most important formulas in all of mathematics. Number one is Pythagoras' theorem. Number two is the triple quad formula. These two are the most fundamental and the most important. The cross law, the spread law, the triple spread formula. If you've been watching this series, you will be intimately familiar with all of these, I hope, and you will know that there's pleasant relationships between them. And I hope you all realize also that the most powerful one is the cross law. In some sense, the cross law contains all the others implicitly inside it. But nevertheless, the cross law is a little more complicated than these two, and I still reserve the role of most important ones for these two right here. These are the most important, although this may be the most powerful. Now, these formulas are just the foundational formulas. They're the main ones, but there are many other formulas in geometry. Geometry is a rich mine of fabulous formulas. And naturally, as we progress in understanding them, they become more and more complicated. Many so-called theorems of geometry can be restated in terms of formulas. And often when we do that, we get more insight and we get more computational power. Formulas allow us to compute something. It's not just talking. It's not just armchair philosophizing. With formulas, we have an orientation which is very practical and no nonsense. We are interested in making computations and answering explicit questions, not making dreamy kind of theories ever and ever higher in the sky. That's our approach, and I think it's a very powerful approach to geometry, including algebraic geometry, which also is, in my view, essentially resting on formulas. Now, there will be an aspect of this that many people who are naturally inclined to geometry are a little bit hesitant to accept. Namely, formulas involve algebra. And if you're geometrically oriented, you might not like algebra so much. What I'm trying to tell you is that if you want to make progress in understanding geometry, you have to address the algebraic underpinnings of the subject. It's unavoidable. And as the theorems become more and more complicated, pictures ultimately become too complicated for even our strongly visual brains to deal with. We need formulas because our computers can deal with the formulas really efficiently. So this is very much a 21st century kind of approach. It relies on the fact that we have more computing power than we ever have, and formulas like this and ones which are much more complicated are a snap to deal with when we have our computers helping us. Let's have a look at an example of such a slightly more complicated formula that plays an important role with our understanding of 4 points. The triple quad formula concerned 3 points on a line. There's also a corresponding formula for 4 points which are collinear. There's 4 points and they make altogether 6 quadrances. So for example, we'll say that the quadrants between these two is say Q2, 4. And there's a relation between 4 of these 6 quadrants. So Q1, 2, Q2, 3, Q3, 4, and Q1, 4 are satisfying this relation equals 0. This is the quadruple quad function which generalizes and extends the triple quad formula. And it's an example of a formula, and a very pleasant formula, that connects with a lot of other things, as we'll see. We'll have a closer look at this later on. I just want to show you an example of a more complicated formula with the idea that you shouldn't be scared about it. It's not so bad. It's actually pleasant. There's symmetry. There's beauty in this formula. And the formula is reflecting very important geometrical information. It turns out, for example, that this expression that's inside the brackets here is intimately connected with that picture I showed you on the previous slide of the 3 tangent circles with a 4th circle around it. A formula that goes back to Descartes and to the chemist Soddy. It's also the case that this quadruple quad formula is intimately connected with Brahmagupta's formula for the area of a cyclic quadrilateral. Why that should be is not at all obvious, but it turns out to be a beautiful fact. So we're going to have to be prepared for dealing with and appreciating more complicated formulas. And an aspect of that is that we're going to be interested in trying to understand how these various formulas fit together to putting some kind of coherence to this sort of family of formulas that arise in geometry. And a very important tool for doing that is the classical object called a determinant. So next time I'm going to introduce determinants to you with a view of using it as a tool for writing down formulas in an efficient way in geometry. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.